Good evening. The water has retreated, leaving behind a thick layer of sludge. Now homeowners and generous volunteers are wasting no time rolling up their sleeves and getting in to start the cleanup because there is a new threat on the horizon. Severe thunderstorms have been forecast for the southeast from tonight. Possible hail, destructive winds and heavy rain.
Thousands of damaged homes are exposed and potentially deadly unsecured debris is lying in the streets. Our reporters have been on the ground right across the southeast. Lane Calcutt begins tonight's special bulletin.
We knew it was going to be bad, but nothing can prepare anyone for this. The sheer scale of the destruction and loss. Thousands upon thousands of households and businesses essentially wiped out and having to start again.
It's really heartbreaking for us.
The Brisbane landscape, for now, heartbreaking mountains of rubbish, in street after street, suburb after suburb. No matter where you looked, it seemed nothing was spared. It seemed all of it was being thrown out.
A lot of people say to us after the 2011 flood, and a couple of people have said already, why don't you leave? Why don't you move out? And this is where my kids grew up. This is our home.
Lifetime memories, family treasures, now trash. What wasn't being tossed out was being moved outside to make it easier to clean inside. At least they've kept their spirits.
We're a bit teary, aren't we, darling? But we got out.
But for some, it was all too much. Andrew spent yesterday helping others. Today, the realisation he's also lost it all, now needing the help himself.
I lost my dad a couple of days ago and I thought he gave me gurneys and I'm like, you know what, Dad, let's go help the street. But my gurneys went under and I felt helpless, but I've got good people coming down now.
There were lunchtime problems in Auchenflower when, for whatever reason, levels began rising, frustrating residents trying to clean up.
The residents of this street are saying, what is going on?
We hadn't seen what they say was record flooding at Deagon on Brisbane's north, but like everywhere and everyone else, they're out there cleaning up after it.
We didn't really know what we were going to come back to.
With so many displaced, their houses ruined, the government's considering offering accommodation at the Wellcamp Quarantine Centre.
If there are people who are single or couples and their home has been completely devastated, and that is an option open to them.
And spare a thought for this Sherwood auto business and its customers. Over 20 cars in for repairs, now needing to be replaced. That's just one case. Then there's this Windsor hockey supply business, only just restocked for the new season.
We're thinking, hundreds of thousands. It's huge.
Hard to imagine the Rocklea markets, lifeblood to the state, could reopen so soon after so much damage. Destroyed fruit and veg thrown out and new supplies rolled in.
This stock will come back in and we'll get it all out again.
Nearby, the anti-looting task force hit the streets overnight.
I believe we've got two vehicles involved in looting down here.
Sadly, with almost immediate results.
An arrest was made and a man was located with property stolen from a displaced business.
There is some good news. Train services resume across Brisbane tomorrow. Public transport is free until Sunday and there are no road tolls till then as well. But there is a new threat. Severe storms forecast for tonight and the rest of the week, threatening to bring even more destruction to an already devastated region.
There is a low probability but potential high impact scenario of isolated, very dangerous thunderstorms with giant hail, destructive winds and locally intense rainfall.
Flood watches have been reissued across the southeast with possible falls of up to 100 millimetres.
There's a risk of renewed river rises from tonight onwards.
Lane Calcutt, Nine News.
Our weather expert Gary Youngbury joins me now. Gary, when might we expect to start seeing these storms?
Well, you've heard just what can happen from some of those warnings, but around an hour ago there was a severe thunderstorm warning issued. It is a general warning, Darling Downs, Greenup Belt, Warrego, Maranoa, Wide Bay, Burnett, but also parts of the southeast from around Gatton to Kilcoy. There is one storm cell already moving towards the northwest of Kilcoy. This is the start of a few rounds, and I think the worst of it is yet to come, being tomorrow afternoon and Friday. We're going to see a lot of action action on the radar. Some heavy falls, damaging winds and possible hail. We'll take a look at the radar in our full weather app in not too long.
Thanks, Gaz. Well, let's go live now to Annie Puller in Clayfield. Annie, you've come across so many heartbreaking stories in your coverage in the past few days, and you've got a great one with you right now.
Yeah, Andrew, tonight we can bring you the story of Jill the pensioner. This is her apartment here in Clayfield, and this is how high the water came up. The 86-year-old has lost absolutely everything. She has no insurance and only moved in 3 months ago, but she isn't alone. There have been a contingent of locals, total strangers here today, helping Jill get back up on her feet. Gary is one of those. Gary, what's the reaction for Jill been, and how can people help?
Jill, when we saw her this morning, she was in absolute tears. I was actually helping out next door, and her story really just grabbed my heartstrings. And all these people actually jumped in off, out of the streets and helped. How you can help is anybody out in community. Her entire belongings have gone, so we're making a plea for bedding, beds, fridges, washing machines, all that sort of stuff. Anything at all will help.
The community resilience has been astounding, and I just want to take you over to Georgia. She's been hand cooking meals all day, delivering them to people. She's here tonight helping these volunteers, and I can tell you by the looks of what I've seen here today, they are going to need the fuel. Melissa?
And destruction on Brisbane's south side as well today. Alex Heinke is live for us at Rock Lee. Alex, some people, just what lies ahead of them is almost so immense. They don't know where to begin.
Yeah, absolutely, Melissa. You've just seen the sort of human impact. Well, this right here is the impact on businesses. This is a smashed repair yard. It's not much of a, more of a car graveyard right now. There's some 150 vehicles. Some of them came in for small repairs to fix a bumper, to fix a ding or fix a scratch. Well, they weren't just being repaired. They will all need to be replaced. We know inside there are some very high-end vehicles, some luxury vehicles. One of them and another one worth $100,000, but one Ford Mustang inside worth $350,000. I spoke to the owner. He only told me he had 10 hours, and it was while he was sleeping, to move all of these cars, and he simply couldn't even get one out in time. So, Andrew, the damage bill is a long way off being finalised, but he believes it could be somewhere around $5 million.
Yeah, some heartbreak there too, Alex. Thank you. Well, we're going to take you to Peter Fegan now at Logan Lee. Peter, suburbs there are completely cut off from each other.
Andrew, this is a very common scene in Logan tonight. I'm on Logan Lee Road, which is one of the busiest arterials in the Logan Shire. And this is what is facing locals tonight. Andrew, effectively the town is divided in two, cut off by floodwaters over low-lying roads like this one. And tonight, Andrew, there are a lot of Logan residents that are isolated. And yes, the water is receding, but it's still lurking eerily close to people's front doors. From the air, you get a true appreciation of the wide-scale damage the rain event left behind in Logan. Homes and businesses inundated, at least 50 homes sustained damage, with both the Albert and Logan rivers peaking.
Places will continue to be cut off as the water comes down the Logan and Albert rivers.
At Waterford, the flood level reached 10 centimetres higher than during the aftermath of ex-tropical cyclone Debbie in 2017.
There's around 3,500 people without power there, and there are roads that are cut. So if you're around those areas, please take care.
Logan Reserve Road now resembles a marina. It's still busy, but tinnies and jet skis have replaced cars. Skipper Justin has lived in Logan for 40 years, and with the exception of 2011, he's never seen it this bad.
To this extent in Logan itself, I don't think any of us were prepared for it, no. Yeah.
To give you some significance of just how deep this water is, the blades of that windmill are the only things still visible, and the sonar reading on this boat currently 6.5 metres. Just over 800 millimetres of rain has fallen in Logan over the past 4 days, and Jim Reglan is still in shock.
Next door is way worse than us. And it's funny because last time they were both level. This time they went under and we didn't. We finished sandbagging here and went down to the Carbrook boat ramp to help down there. And it's...
But in a disaster, there's always some relief, especially for this eel.
You're going to give him a kiss?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, on the lips. There we go. Yeah. Oh, oh.
Caught, then released to live. Fight another day. Peter Fegan, Nine News.
Further south, the cleanup is well and truly underway on the Gold Coast, with the community banding together to remain vigilant in these difficult times. Homes and businesses have been destroyed, but from Yatala to the Tweed, everyone is doing whatever they can to salvage what's left.
It's a sight hard to bear. Floodwaters inundating the little town of Timbulgum, nestled on the banks of the Tweed. Lee has lost everything. His business doubles as the family home. Now it's covered in mud from floor to ceiling.
We'll clean it up. It'll take, just to get rid of the mud and that, we'll take around 2 weeks. And then, I don't know.
The Kennedy Drive boat ramp in Tweed Heads, now a central hub for life-saving supplies. This is the only hope for communities cut off. Passing Fingal and Chindra, where homes are still underwater, a conveyor belt of boats and jet skis, community heroes coming to the rescue. Further upstream at Mwilumbah, it's carnage everywhere you look. As the floodwaters retreat, the scale of the destruction is laid bare.
It's been a bit of a nightmare. The water was really high, come up within 4 steps of the top, so it pretty well flooded everything.
I just feel sorry for these people looking.
They have lost everything, and it's gone in there.
At Palm Beach, a similar tale. Nothing spared in this home, everything but the kitchen sink thrown out.
Oh my God.
Sort of just trekked through, you know, waist, chest deep water with all our stuff to get out. At that time, they actually had the lifesavers rocking up with rubber duckies to go in and rescue people.
For so many, the rebuild begins today.
We couldn't afford flood insurance, so we start all over again and just slowly get what we can together and go from there.
Well, the term legend gets thrown around a lot these days, but there is simply no other way to describe the people I have met today who have showed up in droves to help their community in its time of need. And they've been going all day. The last of the boats are coming in now. They've been going for the better part of 12 hours, and the variety of community heroes who've been helping out is just incredible. Not only your regular boaties and jet skis, we've had the Mad Hooies, we've had Gold Coast jet boating, we've had commercial charter boats as well. And the surfing community has got behind this operation. We've seen legends like Mick Fanning out there today as well.
Today's just all about trying to get food and water and supplies. We're up at Murbar now, so if people are down like Tweed, Gold Coast area, they can drop stuff off at the Kennedy boat ramp.
Lofty, this is only just the beginning. They've today alone managed to amass a whole warehouse full of donations ready to go for tomorrow. So they tell me first thing tomorrow morning, they'll be out here doing it all over again.
Nice one. That's a great response. Thanks, Mackenzie. Let's go to Luke Bradner now at Surfers Paradise. Luke, you always find something interesting. No different tonight.
Lofty, it's just amazing what's washing up on our beaches at the moment. This big tree looks so out of place in the middle of Surfers Paradise. I watched it come in on the early hours of this morning. And also just up the beach, a gas canister and a hot water system washed up this afternoon. Have a look at these drone shots and you can see why we're getting all these debris on our beaches at the moment. Just a sea of floodwaters making its way out to the brilliant blue waters that we're accustomed to here at the Gold Coast. And all of this water is chock full of debris that's going to continue to wash up on our beaches over the coming weeks. Guys, before I go, a couple of great updates. Firstly, the Chindra Tunnel is reopened, which is a godsend for those trapped north and south of the border. And I spoke to our chief lifeguard earlier this afternoon. He told me that beaches will remain closed, Melissa, until at least 11 o'clock tomorrow morning, but we could see some beaches opened as early as tomorrow afternoon.
That would be nice to see, Luke. Thank you. Well, after nearly 4 days being cut off from the rest of Brisbane, finally, traffic is finding its way into Moggill and surrounding suburbs as roads reopen. Nick Kelly is there for us, and Nick, that must be such a relief for residents.
Yeah, to say the least, Melissa. It seems that when authorities finally made the call to reopen Moggill Road earlier today, news travelled quite quickly because talking to locals in town, the traffic jam built incredibly quickly as people made that mad dash out of here to get supplies. If you're wondering why the road was cut for so long, just take a look at that shipping container over there that's just been left sitting against the guardrail after floating across from God knows where. It just shows the volume of water that's been flowing through here. We have some pictures ready to go, I think, of what this area looked like over the last few days, and you just see the thousands of residents in this Moggill, Mount Crosby, Bell Bowery area just surrounded by a brown moat of water. And if we fast forward to the pictures that we shot today, you can see that the difference is absolutely night and day. The area is perfectly clear of water, although there is that brown sludge everywhere, so you can see exactly where the water's been. Now, why people were making that mad dash out of here, take a look at the local Coles today. Shelves absolutely stripped bare, although kudos to Coles, they wasted no time getting a truck in here because a couple hours after this road reopened, staff were hard at work restocking those shelves again. So, Andrew, hopefully a little bit of a return to normality for residents out in this area.
A little bit makes a lot of difference. Good on you, Nick. Thank you.